Can you hear me? Okay, this time I'm not going to play this game with a microphone, so I assume it just works. Okay, now I'm going to talk a little bit about the systemd journal. The systemd journal is something we added in a couple of Fedora releases ago. And it's really awesome in many, many ways. And so we really need to talk about it more so that people actually get to know it and what we can do. This talk's going to be relatively short on slides. I mean, even shorter than the earlier one we did, because I want to have a big part of it just play around with the journal and actually with the command line. So there's a lot of chance for things to go wrong. Let's start a little bit with the journal, like the general why. Why we actually introduced the journal. Who here does not have an idea what the journal is? Nobody shows up. That's already pretty good. But let's explain like a little bit about the history, why we came up with the journal, and why we didn't do something else. So systemd itself is mostly about service management, right? You have all these services, and you want to introspect their status. You want to change their status. You want to see what's going on. You want to start them at boot and shut them down, and all these kind of things. One of the most important parts of it is that you actually have the system control status command, which actually tells you, okay, this service has been running since this time and has these processes. But we always figured out, like, what's really missing there is that we actually can see the last 10 log lines of the daemon itself. Because just looking at from the outside on the daemon in question is not usually that helpful, right? I mean, if you see that Apache is running, you never know if Apache is actually feeling well. While it is running there. So showing the last 10 log lines or something is something we wanted to do for a long, long time. And we can do this now with the journal, because the journal is actually indexed. With a classic syslog system, you didn't have indexing. You didn't have all the metadata that it could actually filter the logs for the specific daemons. And so you had a really, really hard time figuring out the 10 last log lines that Apache did, or that Avahi did, or whatever other component did. Because the syslog format, basically, that was stored in disk is very, very simple. It basically has a tag, which is usually the process name, and it has the process ID, which is even optional and missing in quite a few cases. You have a timestamp that is not localized, that doesn't have time zone information, and is very inaccurate. And then you have a message, which can be in any format, whatever. And filtering things out there by service or something is nearly impossible, at least not possible in a very efficient way. So system control status is basically the core idea. We wanted to make that happen, that we could show those last and everything else comes secondary from that. We figured out the old solution couldn't do it, and we communicated a little bit with the syslog people if they could give us some of this. They added a couple of things for us, but ultimately we figured out if we really want to have this thing that is indexed by default, has structured metadata for every message, then we need to do it on our own. And we believed that it's an inherent, like at the core of service management, and hence doing this in systemd is actually the right thing. Because you can talk about services as much as you want. If you don't talk about logging, you're not really talking about service management. So this is all the other stuff that's also interesting about the journal. It's all condensed in one little slide. It's about structure. So the journal will actually record way more than just text lines. It will actually record all kind of structure for the individual messages. It's very simple, very flexible in a way. It's basically just an environment block of data instead of a single text line. It is indexed. Everything you add to the journal is implicitly indexed by all the fields that you have in this environment block. So you can filter flexibly, and it's going to be fast. It's about security, right? In syslog, you had this problem that whatever you did, syslog would just trust you, right? If you were a normal user and logged something to syslog and pretended to be Apache under this PID, syslog would just take it and would store it away, and you had no way to figure out afterwards, like the administrator would have no way to figure out afterwards, that this wasn't actually Apache. It was just some evil attacker who got access to your system and was logging that kind of stuff. We said it's absolutely important that for every log message that ends up in the journal, in the logs, we can verify that it actually comes from that source that it claims to come from. So this built right into the journal all the way. All the structure stuff that we attach to every message, we implicitly also mark if something's a trusted field or not. A trusted field being something where we have, like the journal has a reliable way via the kernel to know that it actually is valid data because the journal actually verified it or the journal even created it on its own. Yeah, there's more to security actually. There's even something we added there with the classic problem of logging is if somebody managed to break into your system, he usually needs to go and erase his traces, right? I mean, that's what attackers do. They get in, and then they want to make sure that the administrator never figures out that they are in there. So they go to the log files, edit them as VI or whatnot, and remove the lines which said this user just logged in. This is, of course, a huge problem, right? You need to make sure that when the user logs in, he cannot alter those logs anymore and cannot remove himself from the logs so that the administrator has an idea that something went wrong and can trace back what actually happened. Now, traditionally, how this was done is that you have a central log server, and every machine, as it booted up, was immediately logging everything to the central log server. As long as the central log server was reliable and was secure, even if some attacker took over your other machine, it didn't matter because the logs were already immediately as they happened sent to the log server. That of course requires quite some infrastructure because you need to have the central log server, and if you have a cluster of machines around it, this log server needs to be capable of handling all this traffic as it goes on, which might be quite a bit. Like for example, you start up your cluster and every single machine will generate a shitload of messages and bombard the single log server. So in a traditional model, it's kind of hard to deal with because you need to think about the worst case scenario and then have individual infrastructure. So with systemd, make things more secure, we came up with something called forward secure sealing, which allows us to seal off the logs from time to time in a way. It works a little bit like a classic signature, but it's not a signature. That's why it's called sealing and not signing. Where you basically can say, now I put a seal on the journal, which is based on a public key, and then you forget the public key and calculate the next public key, and then you will seal off later again, which basically gives us, because we always forget those keys, you have this effect that when somebody took over your machine, he can just unchange the logs from this point on, where he broke in, but he cannot change history anymore because the old key was forgotten, and he cannot fake those old entries anymore. So this does not give perfect security because the attacker can still go and delete all the logs and remove his traces that way, but he cannot edit the logs anymore, right? And the administrator hopefully noticed that something went seriously wrong if all the logs got missing. So it's not going to solve our problems in the world, but this kind of security stuff, where you can seal off the logs and can be sure that we can recognize if somebody altered them later on, is a big step in making this stuff secure without any kind of centralized infrastructure, where you have to invest money in hardware and think about like individual systems there. Yeah. So security is absolutely important to us. Actionable events is something else we want, right? Log files. They currently contain, traditionally contain these text files, which are supposed to be human readable in most of the cases. However, that is hardly useful if you want to analyze them automatically, if you want to do something if some things happen. So right now there's lots of software actually that tries to analyze log files, right? Log files written out by computer systems. They try to, in human readable language, they try to analyze those log files, and from that human readable language, then figure out what actually really happened to do something else, right? And that's kind of stupid because like you first remove all the context, all the technical context of all the messages, turn them into human language, and then have a computer program to reconstruct all the context again from the human language, which of course is human language is a very, very lossy thing. So for us, it's really important that we have actionable events. This basically means that you can recognize messages without understanding human readable, human language, the English language. So the actionable events means both that you can attach IDs to specific message types, but you can also have the structure that we mentioned before, that if you figured out, okay, this event happened, like, for example, sector bad on my hard disk, that you can also figure out from which device that came and which sector in specific that was. So yeah, actionable events, super important, not available with syslog, and they're awesome. Reliability. Reliability means for us, we want something that works in all cases, right? That works in all conditions, like from early boot to late boot, but also never requires reconfiguration at any time, and always make sure that the log files are not lost and the log files hit the disk eventually. This is like, we have this zero maintenance thing here listed as well. It kind of plays into the same thing. Like, we want something where if a message is locked, it hits the disk, and the disk files are automatically rotated synchronously to that. Because on traditional systems, what happened with rotation is that the system would log and log and log and log, and eventually, via a cron job, rotation would be enabled and would look at the log files and then rotate them away and create space for new ones. However, if the system logged very quickly in very short time, only when the next cron job would be running, disk space is gotten again. So what we want is something that is absolutely reliable, so that the rotation does not happen like by time, but by actual disk space availability constraints. So yeah, the moment you write something to disk, you want to assure that you can actually write it to disk in their space. So yeah, the idea is basically that you can set up a system this way, and you can build it into some hardware and can put it away somewhere in the ground of the ocean, and 5 years later you can take it out and it will not have lost any data, and it will not have flooded anything and will just work. Yeah, centralization is currently, on Linux, we have this thing that there's so many different log systems, right? There's actual syslog, there's auditing, there's kmessage, there's there's firmware logs, there's everything. Like, there's all kinds of different, like, there's WTMP, there's UTMP, there's lastlog, there's all these kind of things that you find in var log and distributed everywhere else on the machine. And the journal is about centralization, so that we take all these sources and can interleave them, so that you actually can see a single stream where everything is ordered by time, regardless of where it comes from. And then you can put filters on top of that. But the idea is basically we pull everything from the entire system into one continuous stream, and then you can have different views on it if you don't want to see everything and be and so on. So yeah, it's about centralization. It's also about localization in a way. I mentioned these IDs earlier about the message types, right? The nice thing is, if a message has a message type attached, like the message ID we call that, then you can actually use this ID to look up localized meta information about a log message. I mean, I personally think it's unrealistic that all services will be fully internationalized any day soon. Like, Apache is probably never going to write out your local language messages. And I don't think we should even try that. I think it would kind of make sense to keep all these low-level things in English by default. But what you want to do is, if the local administrator does not speak English or only speaks English to a certain level, that he can look up right from that message the localized information. So yeah, we have this implemented in the journal so that you attach these IDs, and then there's a message catalog which gives you meta information, which kind of goes into the next topic here, explanation. We want to be able to explain the messages to the administrator so that, I mean, those short messages that are human readable or are supposed to be human readable are usually very, very short and give you very little explanation, like, yeah, what does it actually mean and what am I supposed to do with it and where do I find help, right? What people then usually do, they use those English language strings and look them up in Google, but that really sucks for many, many cases. So again, with this kind of message IDs, we can look it up, look up the individual messages in the message catalog and get all kind of information about it, whatever that might be, in the local language. And this documentation could include, like, explanation what's actually going on and maybe help, like, what you can do about it, and maybe links to support, like, I don't know, it could even be the Red Hat support telephone number and that you can call them. So, yeah. Then with the journal, we wanted to think about cluster and cloud stuff. So whatever we do in the journal should be something that applies naturally to more than one machine, right? And this means a couple of different things. It means, for example, that if you have log streams from different machines and you have all these files on disk, that you can naturally take them and merge them or create a unified view to all of them, regardless where they are from. So you take the logs from the different machines, from your different containers, from your different VMs, and you interleave them, again, by time, and then can filter through them as you want. For example, you say, yeah, I got myself machines, I interleave them, and now I want to see everything Apache logged on any of the machines, and you get a single stream. Repeated PIDs? Yeah, of course, they will be, like, the certain PIDs will exist on every machine, right? Like, starting with PID 1, it's going to be available on any machine. But you can filter that, but it's not supposed to be unique, right? It's, like, the journal does not make assumptions about PIDs being unique over lifetime or over machines or anything like that. By the way, if you guys have any questions, I know I'm speaking very, very fast. I'm sorry for that. I tend to do that, and also we have a lot of stuff to go through. But anyway, if you guys have any questions, then just interrupt me. Standard compliance. It's probably a little bit, probably other people would understand something different under that than we do. Standard compliance for us means that we, instead of inventing our own stuff where we can, we stick to something that already exists. Now, people would mostly request, assume that this means that we implement the actual RFC syslog protocol, but we don't do that. That's what our syslog is for, or something like that. We don't want to get into that business. What we instead do is if we expose something, we try to pick up something that already exists. Like, for example, the systemd journal can be exported into JSON and can it be exported via HTTP. So you can actually use any HTTP client you want. You can download from this, which is actually really useful in embedded devices. You can actually enable this little HTTP service that we have, and then you can use wget to pull out the logs in a couple of different formats from the machine. It could be in JSON, we can do something like the binary export format we defined, or you can actually pull it out in the classic syslog format with one message per line and the timestamps. So yeah, we do B, we do SSL, we do JSON and these kind of things for log transference. But if you want the classic syslog compatibility, you can use our syslog. Implicit context means that we want it for apps to have it easy to log stuff and just forget about it. Kind of further ado about adding additional context about where this was logged from, which basically means the journal D, for every message it gets, it figures out the process, the user ID, the group ID, the SA Linux context, the order information, the service information, and quite a few other properties implicitly, so that the application can just say foo, and then so journal D will actually store on disk foo, and user ID blah, 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 at the same time, and you can filter over that. So it's about implicit context. Whatever happens, journal D will always augment your messages. This is currently quite comprehensive, but we want to add even more stuff, like for example, that we implicitly attach information about the thread or something like that, which currently is missing. Zero maintenance, I already mentioned. And openness means with a journal, we never want to be exclusive, right? I mean, the journal will be always on your system, because it's integrated into service management in every possible way. But we have APIs so that people can get their stuff out of our journal files. We have APIs to get their stuff into our journal. You can run a traditional syslog daemon side by side to it. So we don't really take options away from you in any possible way. We really carefully make sure that we won't lock you in. You can get all the data out of it, you can push the data in of it, you can run traditional stuff next to it, and you will get the whole data the same way as we do.
So can I ask, why cannot we just stand
alone? Because it's about service management, right? Every service that we start gets STD out and STDR connected to the journal, right? Because we want to connect all the stuff. So there's a bit of communication between systemd and the journal so that we connect to it and then do this kind of magic with STD out and STDR. And there's a couple of other things like that. It's user socket activation, blah, blah, blah. It just is a very, very special service. It runs before everything. PID 1 itself will lock to it. It's a special relationship between those two daemons. I mean, it's open source. People can just take and make out of it whatever they want. But for us, it was the natural thing, is because it's so closely related to the state machines that inside of systemd are, that we just made it part of systemd.
So wouldn't it be better to create an API on top of which you can use
you can do write any APIs you want. I don't know. We just provide one. You can use the one that we provide, but you can use something else too if you don't want to use our APIs. I don't know. You know, we don't have an interest to have this gigantic thing where you can replace everything with 20 different components. If you want that, you have the traditional Linux landscape where you have 20 implementations of syslog and 25 implementations of cron and 30 implementations of system, the init system. We actually think that all these kind of commodity things that nobody wants to run, but people just run because they want to run something else, that these are basically... We give you one version that is very nicely integrated, which can do more than everything else can do, but you don't have to use it. I mean, if you don't want to use the journal, just install some other logger, and you can turn off the storage of the journal just fine. But then again, I can tell you system control status is just one wonderful command that you want to use, so actually I would suggest you to leave it on. But it's up to you.
You have to opt out of system being together with the journal. You cannot these two projects
out. Why do we care? I mean, it is the same project. It's like a... But you know, there's a cyclic dependency. Yeah, I'm a bad guy. You know, we looked around, and we looked around. I mean, you know, sometimes you have to do this. We looked around if there was anything that would do the system control status up first thing. If it doesn't do that, and you figure out, could we add it there? And then I mean, our syslog nowadays does all kinds of indexing with Elasticsearch and these kind of things. But the thing is, like, is this really something I want to install in every single machine and even in the embedded device? And then eventually come to the conclusion, no, it's probably not what this is going to be, and we do it in this case. But yeah, I don't know. We
and none of the old stuff was capable of doing structured data.
You know, actually, there are patches of me in our syslog.
There is absolutely no.
So it depends on what you want to do. You have with the journal, it's all the early boot, it's an inner ID and everything, it just works. You with a journal, it enables you for the first time that we get logging right from the moment the kernel finishes initialization all the way to the end. And that is just something that no one ever before. And you get all the STD out and STDR of all the daemons that's never available before. So, I mean, to really make this clear, right, if you run our syslog these days, you will get more information into our syslog or syslog.ng or whatever than you did before, right? The journal, even to think that the journal itself with its storage is crazy idiots by people who always want to rewrite something, you still, by running the journal as this concentrator thing that pulls the data from everywhere, including early boot, like a time-based everywhere and a source-based everywhere, you will still get more stuff in our syslog in the effect.
Yeah.
Well, no, it does. I mean, it really depends. It's like if you want to have an implementation of syslog, then go for our syslog or syslog.ng, right? But the thing is, like, at least I know that on my systems, I won't need this anymore, right? Like, for me, the journal does everything I need, and that includes on my laptop and on my server and everything.
So if I write some kind of email and
I would recommend if you do local logging, always use the journal. And the journal will distribute it to syslog if you want to, but you don't have to.
But the API doesn't matter. You can use any. You can print the standard out and even collect it.
I mean, with the journal, really, it pulls in everything from everywhere. So you can use the systemd journal native API if you want, which basically gives you structured stuff and all kinds of stuff. It's kind of nice to use, actually. You can use the classic glibc syslog call, the one from BSD, and it will just work perfectly. And you can just write to scd out or stdr, and it will just end up there as well. So you can even write it to the to defk message and pull it through the kernel. It will end up in our stuff. It's completely up to you. We pull it from everywhere. We support all these things. We are the centralizer. We will store. We will do indexing and stuff like that. For many cases, you probably won't need syslog, especially in the embedded space and on the desktop. But if you want the traditional syslog protocol, which, I mean, there are many use cases for that, right, because all the hardware speaks that and kind of thing, then go for a real syslog implementation. Anyway, there is more questions. Well, you can turn off the rotation. I mean, ultimately, if your disk is full, your disk is full. You need to do something about it, right? I know that for auditing, for example, there's all these policy stuff that frees the kernel if it can't write the audit stuff. I don't know. Right now, it just looks at disk space and rotates away and makes sure that there's always stuff. But I mean, you can implement whatever you want on it, basically. You just pull it out and just put it somewhere else.
How does it handle write errors if it has an error when writing to the journal?
So currently what happens, if something happens wrong, it will just take the journal file, rotate it away, and create a new one in the hope that works. If that doesn't work, it will eventually log to dev null because there's no other way, right? Like if it can never get a proper journal file again, then it cannot do anything but just say, well, I tried, and then we'll log to k message, a couple of messages about it.
If it's starting logging to dev null, does it
currently doesn't
know. Can you switch it back after you fix
or actually might. I don't know. Oh, honestly, I can't answer you that question because I haven't tried. I mean, I so far didn't have a problem with broken disks that way.
Oh, well.
I mean, there are all these things that, yes.
We'll send you some.
But yeah, okay, if there are no further questions at this point, we will go to the practical phase and I'll actually demo it. Are there So our plan is basically for Fedora 19, we probably enable we kind of go both ways. So we will enable the persistency stuff, which will make system control status a ton more useful. And it's just, but syslog, we're not suggesting disabling our syslog by default. I mean, we might do that eventually, but it's like, a step-by-step process. So basically what this means that you will have all the log files twice in disk by default. And then we can revisit that later on. That's our current plan. And we didn't file a feature about that because, I mean, you usually don't file features if you want to have a directory in varlog, right, in var somewhere, and so we just turned it on. Well, yeah, but what do we size it by disk space by default and this kind of thing, so, yeah. Anyway, so let's go to the practical part. So this is where everything will go wrong. So I have this block star here. So most of the stuff that I'm going to talk about here is actually in this block story from, I don't know, a year ago or something. We can actually check what it is. It is from 24th of October, so it's not even a year ago. I really want to get in the heads of people how awesome the journal actually is to use, because it's actually very useful for administrators every day. So we'll start with, can you actually read this? It's like font is good enough? Should I go this down? Okay, so the most basic command is journal control. If you just type it, you already get something that is incredibly more useful than just looking at varlog messages. So you got something here. So first of all, you got it auto-paged, right? So everybody who comes from Git loves this. People who have not been used to give Git yet, probably say, oh my god, auto-paging, I can type this on my own. But I don't know, I love this feature, so it stays on. Swatch the colors? You want like somewhere here, gray on black, and you want white on black? No, black on white. No problem. So what you see here is basically this output. It is a pixel perfect copy of the traditional stuff we log in Varlog messages. You don't even have to know that there is a structured thing in the background and stuff like that. It will automatically join all files, even the rotated ones, into one stream again. And it will even tell you when logging began, like the first line tells you that. And you see all the stuff here. You have, because there's less, you can scroll to the right and left and things like this. And we do fancy stuff for you, like all the errors, like all the priority information that traditionally were just thrown away in the traditional format that of loggings that it wasn't var log, like all the priority levels where it was thrown away. And we use it here pretty nicely, I think, for coloring things. So you quickly can see, yeah, SMD line there failed to create session, blah, blah, blah. That's the one that was actually an error. And then you see the bold ones. Those are not errors yet, but they're a warning or notice or something like that. So for the first time, we actually make sense out of the priority levels that all the applications specify and people traditionally used for filtering things, but that never actually hit the disk in traditional setups. So
this shows the difference between Git and what you're seeing here, because the date here is October, which is when your log starts, whereas if you start in Git, you get the most recent things going down. So it's very different in Git. That is my objection to doing this way.
What? It doesn't. But no, the Git version doesn't do retrieve, no.
You get the most recent stuff at the top of the
log. No. And Git, no. Oh, that's what you mean. Oh, okay, yeah, you're right on that. Yeah, you have this issue that you also want to rotate it, yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is something like, it's kind of like, if you just do it like this, it will go to the oldest thing right away, which is, yeah, it's just the file and starts from the top. So it's kind of confusing sometimes because you say, what? This is October, what the fuck do I care about October? So. Yeah, you can do that. You can, you can do all or sync. No, yeah, I don't know. It's basically up to Les what it does, right? I mean, we will not do the wrapping for you. We expect that either Terminal does it for you or Les does it for you, or whatever. Yeah, but I don't know. You can specify. And then shift S. Like this. Dash, though.
S, dash,
large S. I did that. There you go. There you go. But it's a last thing. So, yeah, as mentioned, you get this one stream, you get colors. And something that's not so obvious to see, actually, is the timestamp information here. It looks pretty much exactly how it looked in Varlog messages. However, the nice thing is this one is actually time zone corrected, right? This one will actually show you the time zone in what you're currently running here. So yeah, it's really nice already. But it doesn't stay at that. So here's one really nice thing that is kind of to a little bit like what you asked for, dash B. Dash B will actually automatically filter everything for the current boot. So you see, I just booted like on February 24th. A while ago, like because my machine crashed when Kai plugged in the VGA connector. So I had to reboot, and so you see basically everything since the current boot. You see the kernel log messages. You can scroll down here, and it's kind of nice. So dash B, already awesome thing. Now, let's see what we can do. We can do live view stuff, right? You can do, tail dash F varlog messages, probably what most people did on the command line for watching files. We support the very same dash F feature on general control, and you see the last 10 lines. And then if we generate a message, let's see if we can do that. Then you see it appears there right away. So you have this live functionality. And it's again, pixel-perfect copy of what you would get with tail dash F. Then you can do filtering. You can do filtering by priority level. As mentioned, we already do this for the coloring stuff. But you can actually filter by it. So let's see. I want to see all the errors of the current boot. And I type this, and I get these messages. So dash P is for priority. An error is the error level as syslog knows it. And if you write it this way, it will show you everything that is error and more critical than error. So you could, by default, it will show you everything. With this, you can do filtering. That's already kind of nice. Then you can do filtering by time. So you can say, I want all messages since today. See? That starts at today because I, yeah, see, I unsuspended my machine at 10 a.m. because that's when I woke up today. And so you see all the messages there from today. It's already super useful. But you can actually also do, what did they do here in the blog story? You can do until, let's say, I want to have everything until noon. So do this, start at 10, and if we go down, it will actually stop at... That's a part that goes wrong, but yeah, you get the idea. It totally works. Then you can filter by service, right? So let's see, I want to see everything that Avahi logged. So I type dash U, U is for unit, for system unit. And there you go. That's everything that Avahi logged. Oh, by the way, you see one nice feature there as well. Like every time there's a reboot, we actually will add this line reboot, right, on display. So you see, yeah, on October 18, I started Avahi and spit out some bullshit, and then eventually rebooted, and then it spits out some more bullshit. So and you can do that for any service you have. So you have really nice filtering here by service. What else can we do? You can do filtering by binary. So let's see. Now I don't want to, I have no fucking idea how the Avahi service is called, but what I know, let's say, is how the binary is called. So I can do actually, oh, it's probably here. Yeah, it should. So what did I do this time is in the command line, I actually specified the binary pass. And I can filter by that. And I just do that by pressing enter. And now I get everything from the binary of Avahi daemon. I can do that for anything. So let's say, think there's VPNC, for example. I know that VPNC logs a shitload of stuff. So I can do super simple filtering just by using journal control and specifying the binary name. Super awesome. Yeah, I'm not going to ask for Harald's mother. So, but this is already kind of nice, but it gets much better still. So, as mentioned, the journal is actually structured. So right now, we always only output the classic syslog format. But internally, what it actually does is it has the environment blocks I mentioned. So we can use the dash O, which is for output, verbose mode, and suddenly we see for all the entries what actually is logged there. And I have this later thingy. Maybe it actually works. See? So now you see for this entry that it has been sent via the classic syslog BSD stuff. The user ID used was user ID 0. The audit login UID was this, and so on and so on. So everything that you see that is underscored like this is basically the trusted stuff that systemd added. Everything that is not underscored, like these two lines and this here, is basically that we got from the client side. So yeah, it's kind of cool. Now the nice thing is that having all the structure information is the one thing. Filtering is the next thing. So what can we do here? Let's say we want to filter by everything coming from what could be interesting, like everything coming from underscore com VPNC, which basically means every log message coming from a kernel thread that is called VPNC. So let's do this. So we again write use a journal control tool, and now, oh yeah, there's tab completion. I need to show that. It's really awesome. Like I just type underscore co, and then I press tab, and it completes it to com, right? And then I say, so what did I want to check again? Let's do the tab thing again, and there you go. It shows you all possible options of process name. So let's say I want to have everything that sudo logged. And there you go. This is everything that sudo goes. So this is really awesome. And I can do that for any field you want. Right? We had this thing here. And let's say this time I want to filter for anybody who's interested in, let's say I want to filter by SE Linux context. Everybody loves SE Linux. So let's get this going. So what's it called again? This is what I have to do. And then as a Linux context and tab, and then I see this, and I figure out, okay, let's see. I want to see everything that is tagged with the label from the inner label. And there you go, and it shows nothing. Oh. And there you go. So everything, like, and this is kind of, you see here, like, all kind of dirty stuff because you figure out that Bluetooth is actually labeled with initRC, which probably shouldn't be the case. So, yeah, we can do all kind of filtering. Like, any field you see there, you can use for filtering. That's the question.
Can you filter according to the mesh transport?
Yes. Yes. So we can do tab, and we can see, and then we see driver messages are the ones that journal, the self-generated journal is the stuff that was using native stuff.
Maybe I'm wrong, but the messages which has messages which have
Yeah, because they're kernel messages. But the kernel does not give us as much context information. So what, for example, currently does not happen is that all the user space information is attached when it goes into the kernel, so we can pull it out again when we get it out of the kernel. So yeah, I mean, it would be doable. It would totally be doable in the kernel, but currently the kernel doesn't do that. So yeah, this is kind of magic already, because nowadays you have this built into your system. You can filter by time, you can filter by priority, you can filter by any field you want, you can filter by machines, you can do all these fancy things. You can, of course, filter by two things. Like, let's say I want to see everything from my host, and apparently I have three hosts here, Epsilon, Hoo-Hoo. I don't know what Hoo is. So I can filter for host name, and then I can do filter by any other field I want. So this one will give you the list of all the fields ever used in the journal files. Let's say I want to filter by, I don't know, here's a nice thing. Let's say I want to see everything from my host that was generated in specific code files. So here, it's really nice. This is actually, the code file is like a standardized property that is written for all messages using the NICE, the journal native API, and will basically store along every message logged the source code file, the source code line number, and the function name. So yeah, if I want to know, so let tell me everything that was logged from, let's say, the localhd binary, the localhd C file, then I can do this, and I get the output. So yeah, here I have really, really simple, simply combined two filters. And it's actually fancier than that. You can even do like OR and these kind of things. And it actually works automatically. Like, for example, this thing is so smart that it figures out that...
It's even smarter than you.
It's even smarter than I am in many cases. It's so smart that if it figures out that this filter here, it kind of, like, if you look at it like for the first time, you're saying it's contradictory, right? You say, I want to have everything from hostname epsilon and from local, like at the same time from hostname localhost, it's of course conflicting. So this thing automatically figures out, so you probably meant to OR it, right? So that you wanted to see everything that is either from epsilon or from localhost, but also has code file equals this thing here. So it's basically if it starts with a slash, it's a binary. So I'm out of time, but yeah, it's an awesome tool. You should totally try it. It's there's so much more in it. Like, read that blog story. It's really awesome to see this in intact. It already works on your machines. It becomes really awesome if you actually enable persistency, which we will do by default Fedora 19. Yeah, and system control status, if you do this here, for example, for Avahi daemon, you see, it will just print the last 10 log lines. So internally, system control status will do nothing else than just do the same thing that's journal control. And again, all this data is available via APIs, and you can just pull it out there, and my time is over, and I probably should stop. But thank you very much for your time, and if you have any questions, meet us outside.